I have them here.
Let me just get more water.
I'll get it. I'll get it. Rabbi, sit. Sit.
Oh, thank you. Wow, this is great. Okay. Just what I need, except for sugar.
Okay.
You got some sugar, some of that bad stuff, Dovid?
I'd like to welcome everybody to the Kabbalah Shul for an unbelievable evening. I'd like to thank Rabbi Naftali Citron for helping us out in getting this done. I'd like to, of course, thank Julie Bola, the whole Kabbalah family, the board, Shayel, and of course, Peter Atkin for doing the nuts and bolts. Tonight is a very unprecedented, and for me, really, it's like watching a World Series, like the bottom of the ninth, you know, like the Dodgers and the Yankees. It's really, really special for me. I have two fantastic people that I met in my life. I'd like to first start with Rabbi Dovid Sears, who I know about 30 years,
at least.
Dovid Sears was someone that I asked a lot of questions about Breslov. Dovid Sears, I did a little research on Dovid Sears. Dovid Sears was the original illustrator for Mendy and the Golem, which was the first ever kosher comic book. And when it first came out, I remember when it first came out, it was so exciting for kids. It was the first kosher media thing that we ever saw in our lives. That's when the Rebbe was in heyday, and Sivas Hashem. Dovid Sears was behind these pages, making these unbelievable caricatures.
Any way you say it.
Caricatures.
Okay.
Either way, it's
fine. But it's fine.
And the Dovid Sears also was the main illustrator for Art Scroll for many years. I don't want to say everything, but at least 10 books, if not 20 or 30.
No, I think it was 6 books, and it was just a couple of years.
And then the Dovid Sears also has written at least 5 books, if not more, on incredible stuff nobody's ever written. He has a fantastic website called Breslov Center.
The Breslov Center is
mind-boggling. I went on there. Everything is a nugget. You touch it and just bang, bang, bang. Fantastic. So Dovid Sears is a fantastic writer. Then I met Rabbi Bezalel Naor. For me, it was Hashem telling me, yes, David, there is reward in this world. I'm allowing you to grow and to meet new people. And you have gone from darkness to the light. And I'm helping you. Rabbi Naor wrote books on like Sabbatai Svi, which is one of my favorite subjects, and the Kabbalah and the Holocaust, and Rav Kook, I don't know much about, but Ben Naor to me is like a dream come true. He has a fantastic website called Orot.com. Gorgeous website, fantastic books. We have videos of Rabbi Naor speaking for a good 4 or 5 hours on ExcitingJudaism.com. There's a new book out now, if I can show it. The Kabbalah of Relation, which is a pretty beautiful book. Laminated pages, white. I'm not a publisher. But fantastic Chagall paintings relating to the Gemara and to Torah. And the paintings are, the pages are beautiful. Smells unbelievable. Hebrew, fantastic Hanukkah gift. Fantastic coffee table gift. Beautiful gift for Hanukkah. Look at this, it's gorgeous stuff. I mean, it's really nice. And all Jews, from secular, they're going to love it. So, I got my copy. You can buy it on Orot.com. You can contact me at Exciting Judaism. What else? Are we ready to go?
I haven't done my introduction of Rabbi Naor.
Okay.
You have to have double introductions over here. Okay. I want to say something because people that Rabbi Naor.
They want to make sure I have no alum haba left.
No. Rabbi Naor. You know, you heard the term Or Hagonus L'Tzadikim, the hidden light, a hidden light. That there's a revealed light that we see in the world, but the great light that we're yearning for is a hidden light. there are certain people who are also hidden lights. Rabbi Naor is a hidden light. Most people have no idea who he is. His books however many books have reached, and there must be at least 20 of them, or maybe two dozen of them by now, in Hebrew and in English. Heavy scholarly books with tremendous research and erudition, to books that attempt to be more popular works, although the man's brilliance just is so ferocious that even his popular works become extremely sophisticated. But he's a hidden light. People don't know how great he is. And I don't know why that is, but the Gemara says that the greater the man, the greater the Yetzer Hara. This opposition, which has somehow stood in the way of his getting out to people, is still something that we need to see, evaporate. But I have immense respect for him. I consider him to be at the highest tier of Orthodox intellectuals today in the world. And there are some other great people too, but he's right in there. And it's really I owe him a lot. He published two of my books, which I don't know if anybody else would have published or appreciated. And thank God we sold them out, Baruch Hashem. But I'm very grateful for that. And just people should realize, who he is. And this book too also is a phenomenal thing. There are parts of it that I maybe don't agree with, but the creativity and the brilliance of this book and the research and the erudition at his fingertips that went into it is something really truly extraordinary. So that's all I wanted to say. We'll be done.
Katonti Mikola Hasadim. All right, so Miriam, you're going to ask us these questions.
I also want to save questions till later. Any from the audience? No questions there. No.
Yeah, there'll be no interruptions until the end of the dialogue, at which time there'll be Q&A, and that's going to be followed by the book signing, and then at 10 o'clock we go down to pray to God.
Okay. I may have to leave a little bit earlier than that, but we'll...
Okay, so the first question is, what is the significance of the Chagall-Rashab meeting? I didn't even know that there was a meeting. Wow. And the relationship of Chabad Rabbeim to artists in general.
please repeat the question.
Okay, first question is, what is the significance of the Chagall-Rashab meeting? The Rashab was one of the Lubavitcher Rebbe's. And what is the relationship of Chabad Rabbeim or Rebbe's to artists in general?
Right. And that question is addressed to...
Who am I addressing these questions to?
Well, you tell us.
To the board.
I guess we should first start with you.
Yes? Okay.
Seems right.
Maybe you should repeat the question, because the audio may not pick it up. I apologize.
All right, the first question again, significance of Chagall-Rashab meeting, relation of Chabad Rabbeim to artists. Yes, there was a meeting between Mark Chagall and the Lubavitcher Rebbe of his day, Rabbi Shalom Ber Schneerson, known as Rashab by the initials of his name. Rav Shalom Ber is Rashab. This took place in the summer of 1915 in a hamlet called Zaolsha. Let me just give you the Zitzin Leben, as it's called. Russian Jews who were somewhat opulent would have a summer home, a dacha. So the Lubavitcher Rebbe would spend the year in Lubavitch. But then the summer would be spent in his dacha, in his summer home, in this hamlet of Zaolsha. And this is confirmed from both sides. Let me just explain to you how that works. Chagall, in his autobiography, And I've read different versions. There's a French version, Mavi, and then there's the Yiddish, and so on and so on. Of course, there's the English. Records the time and the place. Then I went to what's known as Igrot Kodesh. These are the holy epistles of the Rebbe Rashab. If you know anything about the Lubavitch movement, it keeps very meticulous records of the lives of the Rebbeim, of the seven generations. So you know exactly where they are and what they're doing every time of day. And sure enough, I found that in Tavresh Ayin Hei, 1915, the Rashab is writing letters that summer of Tavrei Shein Hei from Zaolsha. So, you know, as they say, shtimt, you know, it checks out. This is not some surrealistic dream of Chagall. This meeting took place. This is a real, honest-to-goodness, down-to-earth meeting that took place between these two personalities. Now, the question is, what is the significance of the meeting? Good, so two Jews meet, a big deal. Isn't that what Jews do? Don't we meet, we get together? I see in it great significance. I see in it the meeting of two very different worlds, okay? It's the world of Torah, of Kabbalah, of Hasidut, represented by the Rashab on the one side. On the other side, you have a budding artist, Mark Chagall, who has come back to Russia, his birthplace. I don't know if you could call Russia a homeland.
Especially then.
A heimland. I don't think Jews ever referred to it as a homeland, but a birthplace. He's come back to what would today be Belarus from Paris. He is an aspiring artist, and he had already reached a certain level of competence in Paris, and he's now a newlywed. He's just married Bella Rosenfeld. We'll talk more about Bella in a moment. And World War I has broken out. It's 1915. It's the beginning of World War I. Chagall is about to be conscripted into the Tsar's army.
Wow.
And believe me, he could use what's known in Hebrew as etzah tovah. He could use some good advice from a chacham, from a wise man. And at this point, it dawns on him, perhaps he should consult this Rebbe, the Lubavitcher Rebbe. Now, it's a very strange meeting for many reasons. Let me psychoanalyze who the players are.